mileage may vary, but for my money, the 80s metal triumvirate is as follows. Judas Priest, Iron Maiden, and the subject of today's edition of Metal Mythos, except inventors of speed metal, innovators of neoclassical, a major influence on the latent power metal genre, and too many other titles to count. They toured the world, stabbed each other in the back, dissolved into apparent extinction, and then, out of nowhere, just 6 years ago, emerged more merciless and metallic than ever. My top five bands rotates eternal, but the names atop it are immovable. And while Bathory is my favorite band, full stop, except are without question my favorite classic heavy metal act, and today, if I'm successful, I'll adequately illustrate why. We'll review every album in sequence, discussing the notable events thereof. As always, due to the Stretch Armstrongian lengths of this video, there is a timestamp table of contents in the description. Click away and skip from album to album at your leisure, so strap down, pop open a beer, because it's time to plumb the Teutonic Terror. U.D.O., Wolf, Peter, Stefan, Jorg, and or Herman, and yes, we love you, David and Mark. Bitch, you know I'm talking about except. The Siege of Solingen began in a quiet, retiring hamlet in western Germany, an industrial town rather appropriately known best for its background in blacksmithy, coining the town's nomenclature the City of Blades, indeed the sword pommel that would grace the cover of future Accept releases was actually a reference to its anvil-throttling ancestry. The band itself, you guessed it, none other than the Teutonic Terror known as Accept. Where their countrymen, the Scorpions, were renowned for their melody and power pop affectations, except were pure metal.
How big an influence were the Scorpions for you in the early days?
Very big initially, because they were the biggest band in Germany. Musically, we developed in a slightly different direction, obviously. A little more, aggressive and, more metal than rock with the Scorpions. Especially early on, we're more of a rock band, and maybe they still are today, I don't know, but we've always admired them for sure.
But it didn't always start that way. There is perhaps no more circuitous or confusing origin in all of metal, with a band initially comprised of founder U.D.O. Dirkschneider and guitarist Michael Wagner. Yes, that Michael Wagner, the one who produced Dokken's Breaking the Chains, Under Lock and Key, Alice Cooper's Constrictor, Stripers to Hell with the Devil, King's X, Lordy, Megadeth, Janet Jackson, and Mary fuck but a thousand others. And while the band are commonly associated with the new wave of heavy metal in the early 80s, they are in fact a first wave act, founded albeit without success in the latter part of the 60s and slugging it the fuck out for a full decade before finally getting a half-decent break when a chance shot at a local talent show, of all things, netted the band the first recording contract of their career. The year was 1978, and the record company was Metronome, better known particularly at that time as a jazz and power pop label, which perhaps should have been the first clue that the honeymoon would be short-lived.
Ja, man hat versucht, es dann, sagen wir mal, auf Deutschrock umzumünzen, oder Krautrock, wie man es damals genannt hat. Und da habe ich aber eigentlich immer gesagt, nee, mache ich nicht, und ich will Englisch singen.
But despite transparent attempts to temper the band's latent aggression, it was present from word go. Lady Lou, Hell Driver, a clear tribute to Queen's Stone Cold Crazy called That's Rock and Roll, and of course, the pounding Street Fighter. Proof in practice that beneath the painterly veneer of 70s glitz was a heavy metal pioneer waiting to be born, and then they busted in with the ballads. Look, I ain't sobbing about the slow songs, fuck, even Motorhead pulls something memorable from the jaws of commercial cock shit, but when a record company pressures you to write them, well, you wind up with songs like Glad to Be Alone and Sea Winds, not dog shit by 70s hard rock standards, but samey saccharine ballads by any reasonable criteria. So forced was the executive meddling by this point that the record company took to touring the band with fucking new wave acts, like the notorious and ultimately doomed German tour with Extra Bite.
Sagen wir mal so, es war im Prinzip ein Desaster. Und zwar hatte damals unser Label die geniale Idee, uns in Deutschrock mit Deutschrock-Bands zusammenzupacken. Wo ich, sag mal, dann Sturm gelaufen bin und gesagt habe, also irgendwie stimmt hier irgendwas nicht. Und das war also wirklich nicht unbedingt die Idealtour, ja. Das war ganz eigenartig und das hat sich dann auch ganz schnell erledigt.
Ja. Except like the band comprising its namesake was rife with promise. And fuck if that album cover doesn't positively shriek the words German metal. But just as the flower began to bloom, in rode the record company to piss in the fertilizer. If the debut record was discordant as a result of the infighting betwixt a young driven metal band and its tone-deaf record company, I'm a Rebel is what happens when said schism is parted to a cartoonish extreme. On the one hand, if the title track sounds like something AC/DC might have recorded, it's only because they goddamn did, selling the unused Bon Scott-era track to the young German band they were now being almost habitually compared to, and the result was the first minor radio hit of Accept's career. Now I know what you're thinking. How do you even begin to fuck with that formula? They're like AC/DC on bath salts at a time when the swinging dicks from down under, thanks to a little album called, oh, Back in Black, were fast transforming into a fucking money factory. Yeah, well, I got two words and they're both disco. I'm a Rebel has some great shit, and no mistake, the title track was a winner that AC/DC never should have discarded to fucking begin with, quite frankly. Thunder and Lightning rips, and then of course there's the motherfucking classic that is China Lady, but in the overall, this record hobbles itself after every advance. Confused, schizophrenic, self-indulgent, like Phil Spector with a better wig. After I'm a Rebel broke the sound barrier on its trip from Billboard to Bargain Bin, the band were in an uproar. They'd been sabotaged by well-meaning morons, but by the next album, the chains were coming off, and fuck if the results didn't create an entire goddamn genre.
All right, here's something on the new album. Here's something on Breaker.
Speed metal cometh, the nebulous subgenre characterized by semi-automatic percussion and soaring, masterful twin guitar harmonies, the genre that launched a half dozen Mega Man soundtracks and their equivalent metal remixes on YouTube. And it all begins with Breaker. Shattering the shackles of record company mismanagement, U.D.O, Peter, and the Wolf were determined to voice in their bubbling frustrations in song form, and the result was one of the finest releases of their career, and despite hailing from Germany, a formative work for the burgeoning new wave of British heavy metal, in the process branding the Germanic militia as the only true honorary members of the early 80s NWOBHM wave that gave us the likes of Maiden, Savage, Raven, and countless others. And speaking of militias, it was near the end of this era that frontman cum cave troll U.D.O. Dirkschneider would cleave his golden locks for a paramilitary makeover. And with that, the final tumbler clicked and fell into place. The band wore military jackets, their commanding Napoleonic frontman bedecked in camouflage. They set about the globe for metallic conquest.
But it was very funny, I mean, how I came to all this camouflage thing. So yeah. We was looking in the 80s for something different. And then we went, I don't know, just for an accident into the NATO shop or whatever, military shop. I put this stuff on, and just for fun, I said, and then everybody said, that's it.
And then, and then in a way the character was born. I mean, and then, they managed to make it happen. Maybe you cut your hair short and go, okay.
And
okay,
you
another
that.
Thing. And I did that, of course. I mean, so, and then I was watching me, and then I said, yeah, this is in a way more me, you know, how, all the movements, I'm not David Lee Roth, you know, on stage, I'm moving more a little bit like a German, how you call it, German tank.
An early 80s tour with Judas Priest proved to be Accept's coronation, forever altering the band's sound, look, attitude, and standing within the metal community. Accept had arrived, and all they had to do was tell the record company to fuck themselves, and much like Queen before them, they elected to do so through song. But it was the savagery, aggression, replete with jaw-dropping solos and hooks that proved the album's hallmark and would pioneer the band's formula going forward, characterized in particular by the neck-snapping headbanger of a title track and my personal favorite, Run If You Can. The ballad Can't Stand the Night, if a trifle on the sappy side, is made eminently more memorable due to the simple fact that its acoustic introspection actually stands in contrast to the rest of this excellent record. Bye, Breaker Bitch!
In these previous albums, we listened to a lot of opinions from other people. We said, oh, you gotta be more commercial, so we tried I'm a Rebel. You gotta be more radio friendly, so we tried something like I Wanna Be No Hero, and songs where we all thought like, eh. Yeah. It's not really, it doesn't feel right, you know? Mm-hmm. And on this one, we just said, fuck it.
It is virtually impossible to overstate the enduring impact of Restless and Wild. This album is the titties! Actually, fuck this cover art. I mean, I love vinyl and all, but that right there, the two burning flying Vs, that's your fucking Restless and Wild cover art as far as I'm concerned, representing the concurrent nexus of all the rapidly codifying virtues of the nascent NWO BHM scene, perhaps the most coherent expression of the protozoic speed metal genre, and perhaps the true definitive birth of what would come to be known as the Accept sound. Every subsequent Accept record would be measured against its metallic might, and with good fucking reason. Restless fucking rips. We open with a fake-out German folk tune that, despite having nothing whatsoever to do with Nazism, for some batshit reason, remains verboten in France and Poland to this day.
It is immer noch so in Polen, das ist wirklich kein Scherz, sing ich kein Heidi Heido Heida, ja?
Okay.
Hab ich jetzt gerade in Warschau gespielt.
Ja.
Lass ich komplett weg. In Frankreich mache ich auch kein Heidi Heido Heida, weil da geht ein Five-Konzert los. Ja, auch heute noch.
Wahnsinn.
Das ist irre.
And from there we're off to the races, motherfucking literally, beginning with the neck-snapping speed metal savagery that is fast as a shark, into the groove-laden valleys of the title track, Ahead of the Pack, Demon's Night, and all the rest, but the true standard for this uncontested heavy metal masterwork was the 6.25-minute Sonic saga known as Princess of the Dawn.
Princess of the Dawn.
Really, there's only one dud on the whole record. A fetid chunk of rancid dick cheese by the name of Don't Go Stealing My Soul Away, but literally every other minute of this record is perhaps the singular peak of the classic metal period. Bathory may be my favorite band, and The Return my favorite album, but as I said, almost by itself, this one album catapults Accept to its uncontested status as my all-around favorite heavy metal band. Exceptional in every solitary respect, beg, borrow, steal if you must, but by this shit. With sweepingly successful tours with the likes of Priest and Crew at their back, and a nigh-universally acclaimed record spinning in Victrolas across all of Christendom, except were poised for prosperity. They languished in limbo with ass-banded executives, fought and won their freedom, and emerged as perhaps the single most promising prospect in all of underground metal. Everyone seemed to tacitly agree that the German Panzer Division were just one major offensive away from heavy metal immortality, but Christ in a cocksock, no one could have anticipated the balls-out barbarous teabagging we were about to endure.
I'd like to say that we're really glad to be back in Japan, and we always enjoyed it here, and this is going to be incredible this time, and this is balls to the wall!
As I've discussed on many of the occasions, some albums long since established, either by press or public sentiment, as immutable classics upon further review are more along the lines of mediocre. I regaled you all with my bewilderment at Number of the Beast seminal status in Maiden Mythos, an opinion I stand the fuck by for the record, and anyone who doesn't like it can give me a back bin BJ, and I express similar but less severe sentiments toward British Steel. But then there's albums like Motorhead's Ace of Spades, and this fucking beast I hold in my hands. Right from the opening riff, anyone with an unobstructed ear canal becomes acutely goddamn aware of one existential truth. Balls to the Wall is considered one of the greatest metal records ever pressed to a mass of vinyl, because that's precisely what it butt-fucking is. The logical extension of the previous two peerless releases, while carving a unique melodic metal niche often imitated and never once convincingly reproduced. You will have this record lodged in your neocortex from now to next fucking fall. Wolf Hoffman positively outdoes himself, crafting some of the most haunting riffs and soaring guitar melodies in the history of the art form, steering further still into the neoclassical influences pioneered on the previous release, while retaining a street-level raunchiness that at times quotes but always perfects the most sterling elements of Priest and the almighty Motorhead. Breaker was boss, Restless rips ass, but with Balls to the Wall, guitarist Wolf Hoffman ranked up to Riffmaster General, and Sears Tony Iommi's handlebar mustache cleaned the fuck off, soaring nowhere more majestically than on the Anthem to Insurrection, a prescient piece given our current political travails, the title track. Nary a runt in the litter, by the midpoint, the album is still fucking incredible. From the whiplash serenade of Losers and Winners to the haunting personal favorite of mine, Losing More Than You've Ever Had. Be remiss at this point to fail to mention the lyrics. With the feckless five-piece consisting of non-English natives, Wolf enlisted the help of the band's manager and his wife-to-be, the lovely Gabby Halfka, to brandish the poison pen anonymously under the pseudonym of Deffy. The result? Pounding metal with a peculiar, androgynous, vaguely feminine worldview. Every engorged cuntflap who claims 80s metal is all about boning broads and doing lines should have Balls to the Wall's lyric sheets stapled to their semen-caked foreheads. The album explores every lyrical theme from systemic oppression to emotional abuse, and yes, in 83, the heart of the AIDS stigma, it even included Love Child, a song about a confused teenager's battle with their own emerging homosexuality. Don't know what I am, a woman or a man. Many trials behind me. I'm doing what I can, but I'm what I am. Leave me alone, I'm a secret. Feeling the power of lust and God's blessing violence. Breaking my spring, I'm going to save up a while. moments of daring like this, along with the band's ill-advised propensity for wearing lime green neckerchiefs and locking in one massive impassioned Eurotrash embrace on stage, led to the band being tacitly regarded as gay metal by abject retards of the period. Balls to the wall is every abiding virtue in Restless and Wild, with that all-important additional degree of polish, commerciality, and dear God make it stop catchiness. Bottom line, masterpiece. Get it. If Balls to the Wall represented a bold step forward in terms of commerciality, Metal Heart was a quantum fucking leap. Far and away the most radio-friendly record the band had produced to that point, but with a darksome, metallic meatiness that has since proven immutable to legions of metalheads the world over. Perhaps no element more singularly defines Metal Heart than guitarist Wolf Hoffman's complete embrace of all things neoclassical, even going so far as to quote pieces of classical music on the album itself, but nowhere more successfully than on the titty-fucking title track. Is it poppier, poncier, and all around more listenable? Undefuckin'-niably, but I dig the living shit out of Metal Heart regardless. This is the logical musical progression from the catchier climbs of its testicularly inclined predecessor, and thus the additional mass market appeal never once comes across as forced. And with some of the most heavy-handed hooks you will ever hear, you'll be far too busy trying to bore the fucking chorus out of your brain to ever pause and take stock of just how it happens to be tailor-made for radio. But it also excelled in the realm of video, as the immortal Midnight Mover promo unwittingly invented the very same 360-degree spinny cam effects that a couple Hollywood hacks would bankroll in a multi-million dollar sci-fi franchise in the late 90s. Oh, don't mind except, guys, they're just busy giving the Wachowskis a fucking career. And don't mind the most epic U.D.O. taint shot in heavy metal history either. But while the music was riding high, tensions within the band were rapidly approaching a boil. As Wolf and Peter attempted to capitulate to management pressures to chart an ever more profitable commercial course, the dwarven Dirk Schneider with his sandpaper bellow, Napoleonic height, and Jim Henson creature shop good looks was fast lapsing into liability. The end result is still a tried and true classic in the catalog, and I recommend it highly as such, but it wasn't long before the party came to a bloody finish. In music, as in politics, whenever one moves too far in any single direction, they're liable to face a righteous whiplash in the opposite. So it follows that when Metal Heart bum-rushed our radio receptors, its follow-up would represent a concerted attempt to refocus, retool, and reconstitute the fist-pumping foundry known as Accept. 1986's Russian Roulette is, in that sense, something of a letdown. Oh, it revels in the rapid-fire assault of TV war and another second to be, but the inner conflict within the siege engine known as Accept was flagrantly apparent on some of the sappiest songs yet penned by the group in question. It's Hard to Find a Way and Man Enough to Cry are paragons of pussery, albeit pussery with damn good hooks. Oh, Oh, you cringe now, but 4 hours from now, you'll look up from masturbating with your own tears in the shower and curse my name and existence as you tacitly concede this song will be lodging your medulla for the next 50 fucking years. As for the best song, tough call. With peaks like Russian Roulette and the massive Monster Man, you all but forget the album has any valleys. But nothing has my devil horn standing more ardently erect than the breathless aviation anthem, Aiming High. Division within the realm of the 10-ton Teutons was obvious from the discordant musical result, but through sheer talent and performance, Accept had delivered a balls-out barn burner. Russian Roulette, for all its issues, may actually be better than the eminently classic Metal Heart. But a catastrophe was lapping at their heels, and it would not be denied for long. As the band began work on an even more aggressive follow-up, the slavering suits made their play. Hearing the latent musical potential for breakthrough success on some of the poppier cuts on Russian Roulette and Metal Heart, and recognizing the mounting tension between the songwriting duo of Peter and the Wolf and their inimitable frontman U.D.O. Dirkschneider, the record company at last intervened. Lose the midget, ditch the more metal record you've already recorded, go for the Bon Jovi brass ass ring, hire a guy whose accent isn't thicker than his forehead, and we will proceed to shower you in all the coke, hooker BJs, and platinum fucking records you can shake a pair of groupie titties at. And just like that, U.D.O. Dirkschneider, the iconic frontman who had founded the band to butt fucking begin with, was gone like the dickens, taking his signature sound and dominating stage presence with him. And that wasn't all he took.
Sag mal so, das ist eigentlich das Traurige damals gewesen. Ja? Sag mal, da ist irgendwas kaputt gemacht worden. Wer auch immer das gemacht hat, im Endeffekt, das hätte eigentlich nicht sein müssen. Ja? Und ja. Da sind natürlich auch viele, sag ich mal, böse Geschichten aufgekommen, etc., etc. Ja? Das ist eine lange Story. Für mich war das eigentlich ziemlich einfach. Animal House war eigentlich der Nachfolger von Russian Roulette.
Ja.
Dann haben die gesagt, ja, die Songs kannst du alle nehmen, wunderbar, die brauchen wir ja sowieso nicht machen. Danke.
While the parting of ways between U.D.O. and the U.D.E.T.S. was fraught with animosity bordering on hatred, a wound that remains very much open to this very day...
I was watching a show of Accept in Hamburg, and I was a little bit disappointing, you know, it was without any emotion. For me, there was no band on stage. Playing-wise, it was okay, but it was without any emotion and without...
Automatic.
It was automatic, like do it and then go.
It's just hilarious at this point. It's just a big joke in our lives, and we just go on about our lives, and we do our thing, and we let these things go by and laugh about it. He's actually sort of our press agent in a way, you know. He keeps us.
To his credit, Wolf and the Boys did proffer a monumental peace offering. You know that spine-snappingly aggressive classic Accept record we already recorded but no longer intend to use? It's yours, U.D.O. Go with God. The end result was Animal House, the first release from U.D.O.'s spin-off band U.D.O., and the eighth Accept album that never was. It goes without saying, then, that Animal House is the closest U.D.O. would ever come to sounding like vintage Accept. Later releases would become progressively more mechanized, thrashy, and processed, but Animal House stands utterly apart as a more organic offering, undoubtedly owing to Hoffman and Baltus' inimitable songwriting thumbprint. Sadly, the production itself was anything but up to the task. With wafer-thin bottom end and dog whistle treble, this may be the single most Caucasian album ever released. But if you can tolerate the high-pitched crunch, this record is every bit the barrage of badass that the previous two Accept releases were. Sadly, I do think the record was somewhat hampered by mismanagement almost from the outset. Namely, who the fresh fuck decided to release the weakest, most droning and repetitive song on the record as the goddamn single? Hey, look, it's Hillary's campaign song. Animal House is a little spotty on the execution, but as a pure top-to-bottom heavy metal record, I'd put it up against almost anything in the Accept catalog. It's that goddamn good. Not to be outdone, Accept would take an unprecedented 2 additional years before burning an album of their own, and almost from the opening bell, it was apparent that not all would go according to plan.
There was one moment that Dieter told me about halfway through the record. He stopped, you know, he put me on pause, and he turned his chair around and said, you realize if this record fails, it's your fault and my fault. And he couldn't have been more correct, you know. I mean, I didn't get what he was saying because he's far more experienced than I was. And when he turned around and said that, I looked at him, and it kind of pissed me off. Like, why would you say that? And he said, you'll see. Reality. If it hits, we're going to be gods. If it fails, we're losers.
Arguably the single most routinely reviled record of the 1980s, the eternally controversial Eat the Heat took its time barreling on down the birth canal, not least of which due to the fact that it essentially had to be written 3 times. There's the more metallic version that ultimately became UDO's Animal House debut, the final product, and a sort of working edit that is reputed to be even more poppy, bordering on AOR Bon Jovi bullshit that was ultimately, thankfully, discarded. Filling the size 3 combat boots of the domineering Dirk Schneider was a daunting task bordering on impossible, but they found a worthy successor in former Bonfire and Bangalore choir frontman David Reese. Equally adept at melodious crooning as with vintage Accept shrieks, he was a masterful vocalist by any reasonable measure, and his live footage of the band's tour for the album confirms he boasted conceivably greater stage presence than the man he replaced, which is no mean feat in and of itself. In theory, all the ingredients were present for a bona fide hair metal classic, and perhaps judging objectively, that's precisely what Eat the Heat is, but for me at least, it's a lopsided affair. The highs are doing backflips on the Everest summit, but the lows, White Lion wouldn't wipe their ass with. That said, perhaps no Accept album has a greater capacity to surprise with its musical depths and narcotically addictive hooks than this one right here. This is the album I turn to when I'm in the mood for a pleasant surprise, kicking off right from the outset with the merciless XTC. Years later, U.D.O. would re-record the song in question, as perhaps it always should have been, but tracks like Ecstasy, D-Train, and Chain Reaction are proof positive that when the long-departed former frontman states that despite its poor reputation it has some exceptional songs regardless, he's not trafficking in mere diplomacy. This album has its fans, and they are devout. I just can't say I'm one of them. Next!
Für mich ging es damals eigentlich auch nahtlos weiter. Ich habe da in Hard and Heavy damals noch Fernsehsendung mit Annette Hopfenmüller, die es bei Tele5 gab, They Want War gesehen als ersten Videoclip zum Album und dachte, genau so muss das nächste Accept-Album eigentlich klingen.
Yep.
Und es ist, ich konnte es nicht nachvollziehen. Also
konnten damals viele Leute nicht. Und mir hat hinterher mal Dieter Dirks bei einem Bier gesagt, das war der größte Fehler aller Zeiten. Ja. Ja.
Looking back, I can, you know, we could have done it differently. On the other hand, there's some songs in there I really like. You know, it sounded different. The mixing, the production part is really at the end, you know, it got out of hand. And Dieter Dirks had so much to do with this, you want to do it. At the time, it was Def Leppard was really big,
right.
And this whole thing. And first computers got involved in music.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting point. That was the first time when all of a sudden was, things were moved and,
okay.
And, you know, and it wasn't about the playing anymore. It was about how far can we push it to make it sound like this.
Right.
So when you listen back to it, the meat of the songs is really good. It's just, it never, it should have stayed a demo and should have just been recorded. It would have been fine.
Right.
Let's get this out. big audience out there, and all the letters said the same thing, you know, you left a gap, you know, we're still missing, except nobody put your shoes, you know, we still want to hear that kind of music.
It was a good experience for me to play with different musicians, and now, in the end, you know, when this live album came out, I mean, I knew that there was something missing, you know.
In the same way that Kurt Cobain's Buckshot Serenade sired the radio rock ass-ramming we're still presently biting the pillow and dutifully enduring, Pantera, namely its breakout Cowboys from Hell release, devoured an entire generation of would-be metal bands alive. From Loudness burying longtime frontman Minoru Nihara at the base of Mount Fuji, recruiting Masaki Yamada and going from teased hair and leather pants to shredded jeans and pot stench, to Rob Halford's short-lived shot in the arm named Fight, to whatever in the wet fuck George Lynch thought he was doing in the 90s, Dimebag dropped a deuce on the decade, and we've been plugging our noses and enduring the shit stink ever the fuck since. So conceive my disappointment when the David Reese experiment was scattered to the four winds after testing the waters with a superb live release entitled Staying Alive. The original lineup reformed, and just as expectations took full flight, you learn not even accept we're safe from the backwards hat brigade. Fuck this gay earth! Look, there's nothing patently offensive about Objection Overruled, and the best songs on the album will be carved in your forebrain forever. Look no further than Protectors of Terror. But it's always an exercise in eye-rolling when a band discards its essential character for fleeting relevance. Objection Overruled is more consistent, perhaps, than Animal House and Eat the Heat, but its highlights are surprisingly muted for a band of this caliber. I dig it, but it's not the first Accept album I'd reach for in a pinch. Fuck, it probably wouldn't be the ninth. But it was better than what was to come. There's a listless quality to mid-period Accept. It was the 90s, there was a prevailing sense the band had reformed just in time to be fucking ignored by a music industry that was cramming grunge down our collective throats, and thusly, musical adjustments were made almost immediately. Which is a bit of a shame, as the album U.D.O. did right the fuck before rejoining his old band, the Titanic time bomb over here, seemed to me a better direction for Accept to take musically, sharing more in common with Judas Priest's Painkiller than Pantera's Far Beyond Drivel, but by God, this was the course, and they would white-knuckle the fuck through it come hell or half-empty clubs, which is precisely what they were playing to by year's end. Death Row is a product of its time. Repetitive riffs, facially conscious, oh-so-very urban lyrics, stripped-down production with a complete absence of a second guitar player. Fuck you, 90s. Fuck you in the face hole. But for all the filler, Death Row did have one noble purpose. We finally got to hear U.D.O. sing the Eat the Heat single, Generation Clash. And I have no conceivable godly idea how Accept's metal remix of Pomp and Circumstance was never used as Macho Man Randy Savage's theme music. For fucking shame, WCW. All in all, Death Row sounds like it was fucking recorded there. There's a highlight or two, but is it worth the cartoonish out-of-print prices on Amazon? Fuck to the no it ain't. Next. Accept boasts easily one of the most consistently superb discographies in their stated genre, but it ain't all gold. Ask any metal fan out of the Yellow Sun what the worst record in the band's discography is, and 11 times out of 10, they'll either say Eat the Heat, or the album I hold in my pallid digits as we speak, Predator. As for myself, I'm a touch more forgiving to this album. Honestly, after the pathetic Pantera plagiarism of the previous two releases, I find Predator a welcome realignment to Accept's hard rock roots. With that said, it's still more unbalanced than a one-legged tightrope tumbler on a windy day. For every anthemic rocker, a fountain of forgettable fluff, often of interminable duration that outstrips a Gregorian chant for sheer breadth of mind-numbing repetition. And that's really Predator in a nutshell. The lows are among the absolute lowest in the band's career, but what rarely gets mentioned is the highlights are some of the most unfairly forgotten second-look classics Accept has ever recorded. Tracks like Lay It Down, Take Out the Crime, and Heart Attack completely offset the fuckload of filler festooned across this record, but it's the melodic metal masterpiece known as Crossroads that soars above the fray. Say what you will about Predator, the band channeled their internal turmoil and emerged with one of the greatest Accept songs ever written. And that's really this album in a nutshell, a band in flux, thrashing confusedly through the 90s, pulling in four different directions and incapable of making headway in any of them. The band had moved to separate corners of the globe with Stefan and U.D.O still residing in Europe, and Peter and the Wolf living in Philly and Nashville respectively, and their musical taste had migrated nearly as far afield as their physical locations. To make matters worse, it was the mid-90s and nothing could have been less cool or profitable than playing the exact type of music they were at that moment. After a brief club tour throughout the following year, recorded and ultimately released as the brilliant live release The Final Chapter, Accept called it a career, and for the next decade and a half, that's where it seemed the Accept story would end, with a whimper and a half-hearted retreat from the mundanity of the 1990s, perhaps the most unceremonious demise in metal history. Or was it?
I mean, it's really almost like a... You couldn't make up this kind of story. Peter and I were not, you know, U.D.O chose to not be part of any Accept ever again, and he left the band 25 years ago, so that ever he said he made it perfectly clear, no more Accept for him. And then we kind of had given up. We didn't think there was ever going to be any more Accept. And one day he and I were just playing music for fun, jamming, and somebody suggested we invite a singer who lives close by so he could join us just for a fun afternoon. And that name was Mark Tonillo.
In the aftermath of the band's implosion, the Duke of Durkschneider reformed U.D.O. and went on a tear of tremendous albums that continues unabated to the present day, with Stefan Kaufmann coming along for the ride as rhythm guitarist. But Wolf and Peter were effectively retired from the music business entirely. Words cannot express how agonizing it was to be an Accept fan during this era. Your only abiding desire is to see your favorite band reform and storm the world once more, and yet every time either party opens their yap and discusses the subject, they're trashing the living shit out of each other. If you thought the Dokken breakup was toxic, look up some U.D.O or Wolf Hoffman interviews from the late 90s to the early 2000s and brace for full-bore bitterness.
What is your pet peeve question? Of, you know, like one that someone asks you every time and you go, argh. What, you know, like, why did he ask that again? Why do I always get asked this
question? Always Accept questions.
Okay. Anything having to do with Accept.
The 2005 reunion was a resounding success, however. Playing before packed audiences across Europe and particularly Russia, where Accept has enjoyed a shockingly devout following since the 80s, optimism began to bubble to the surface.
U.D.O. Durkschneider heads off to Red Square.
except last played Moscow in 1993, and much has changed since then. But the old fans are loyal as ever, and new fans have joined them. German heavy metal is big in Russia, and Accept is one of the very biggest here.
We agreed to do the festivals first to see how it goes. And if it carries on in the rest of the world the way it has here, we'd be pretty stupid not to go on. Who wouldn't want to keep going?
The fans in Moscow, at least, would be happy if Accept stayed around a bit longer.
I was even fortunate enough to actually see them on their summer festival tour back in 05. But almost from the very beginning, the old issues began to overturn the apple cart.
I don't want to go too deep in this, you know, but we did a reunion, and in the end, it doesn't work out.
Oh, okay.
So then we did, in 2005, some festivals over the summer in Europe. And there was no plan to do a reunion, stuff like that. So, and then when they start now the... Again, a reunion. Wolf, I don't know what he's talking about. I heard he said, no, we were not asking Udo, blah, 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 but this is not true.
Okay.
They asked me to do the reunion, and then I didn't say directly no. I said, okay, we can talk about this. And then we had a long talk, and then in the end, I said, sorry, guys, but under these conditions, I don't want to do this.
And just like that, Udo was back with his namesake, and Peter and the Wolf were left pondering their future. That's when a chance encounter with a former singer of 80s Accept sound-alike T.T. Quick altered metal history forever.
I just got a phone call one day, and, you know, long story short, went down there to jam with Wolf and Peter, and it was just it was just a friendly little get-together, scream a little, sing some old stuff.
You took your shirt off.
Throughout, I was hot. It was just usually the case.
I fit.
Of course, Udo's version of the story boasts not only a different timetable, but a generous quantity of shit-flinging.
Of course, he was asking me in the first place, and Stefan also, and oh, can you maybe do a reunion? And I said, guys, and then we said, okay. We told them, okay, under these conditions, we can do this. But this was maybe a little bit too much for them. And then we said, okay, guys, the risk for us to cut down U.D.O. again and do maybe one Accept album and tour, and it doesn't work again.
That could be true.
I said, no, the risk is too high. I said, okay, forget it. But I was a little bit angry, you know, a bit about this. And then they said, they was talking to everybody, without U.D.O., Accept never will happen again. 2 weeks later, I saw Accept is back. Come on, it's a joke.
And I have to own up to my own skepticism here. Prior to the release of the album in question, when Accept announced their intention to move on with a different singer, I just about shot fire from my fucking eyeballs. And the subpar re-recordings they uploaded as a MySpace teaser turned that fire into a fucking blowtorch.
We were so excited. Even we put some stuff that we recorded on the first day with Mark when he was sick on the internet, me and Wolf. Like little kids, you know, going, oh, I want everybody to hear it. And everybody wrote back, this stings. And we were like, oh, I better write a good album.
Who fished Gollum from the fires of Mount Doom, and why's he been huffing the helium? In my defense, what we didn't know at the time was the new singer, Mark Tornillo, had the flu when this demo was recorded. But the internet hate machine was already in third gear, steamrolling the German metal legends with an onslaught of acrimony. I'm happy to say I didn't contribute to it, but satellites could spot my skepticism from space. And then it dropped. Its name was Blood of the Nations, and it tore our assholes clean asunder. I have never been more elated to be mistaken in my life. Recruiting Megadeth producer Andy Sneap, himself a fellow ardent Accept fanboy, after hearing some early demo tracks that still hadn't shaken the 90s Panterrible influence, his advice for the legendary band was simple.
He forced us, locked us up in a room, and forced us to listen all the way through to Restless and Wild.
I was aware of a lot of little traits
that made Accept sound like Accept.
And pointed out things that he thought were specifically Accept.
Little pushes on the drums, the anthemic feel at times. I just wanted to make them aware of this.
How good was the final product? Look at this copy. Look at it. Look at those frayed edges. This fucker is falling apart as tacit testament to the fact that once this masterpiece dropped, it did not leave my car stereo one time for the next year. Blood of the Nations is that goddamn good. Not a dud on the record, which is more than you could say for most of the fucking classic releases. This is arguably the finest metal comeback of the millennium. Classic metal, modern production, buy the fuck out of it. After the dizzying heights of Blood of the Nations, some, including former frontman U.D.O, expressed disbelief at the prospect of the band being able to fashion a follow-up. After 14 years, I'm not surprised it's good, he jibed. Whether they can do it again is another matter. U.D.O, buddy? Famous last words. We didn't have to wait long for the follow-up to 2010's Metal Album of the Year. After just a 2-year hiatus following a world tour that, with a few lone health hiccups, can best be described as triumphant, including a festival gig opening for the almighty AC/DC, the resurrected Frankenstein incarnation of Accept, had officially departed the operating table. It was loose in the village and no flower-picking 5-year-old peasant girl was safe. And while I'd put it just a hair below Blood of the Nations, 2012's Stalingrad did not disappoint. With the self-same pristine production job and an even greater emphasis on the neoclassically inclined majestic melodies of the metal heart and Russian roulette eras, Stalingrad was both a tribute to the die-hard Russian faithful that have treasured this band since time immemorial, and a logical musical progression from its superb predecessor. That is some classic shit any way you slice it. Where the album loses some points for me is in some of the more meandering passages. The album closer, The Galley, has just never quite clicked for me. If you dig it, more power to you, but for me, it just kinda lies there defying me to give a shit. But quite literally, every other track on Stalingrad absolutely smokes. This record is sensational and you should fucking listen to it. By now it was clear the reborn Accept was no mere aberration. They'd cranked out a classic and given it a worthy sequel. The only question now was how they would fare in the stretch. Like clockwork, the calendar hit 2014, and just 2 years later again, we had our answer. Blind fucking rage. Simultaneously more melodic and aggressive in perfectly equal measure, and that characteristic Andy Sneap polish was present and accounted for. At first, I was a little taken back by the record. It wasn't quite as immediate as the albums that preceded it, but after stewing on it a bit, I'm gonna be straight up about this. Blind Rage is the best record the new incarnation of Accept have recorded to date. It has the speed, it has the ferocity, it has these monolithic leads of Wolf Hoffman and Herman Frank, but with a welcome additional element that, with retrospect, was sometimes missing from the band's latter-day output. Commerciality. Look, say what you will, but early Accept had radio-ready tracks like Midnight Mover and Monster Man on even their most celebrated aggressive releases. And in that sense, with songs like Dark Side of My Heart, the final piece of the classic Accept sound has at last clicked into place. Blind Rage fucking kills, folks. It's a bit of a grower compared to its more immediate older siblings, but once it sinks those fangs in, they go deep. This record will pummel your ass in perpetuity.
You don't have to change all the time. We're trying to not change. We're just trying to get better and have new songs for the fans. But to change is always easier than a thing to not change. You know, to do something consistently in a certain quality over a longer period, I think that actually gets harder and harder.
By the time 2017 got rolling, Accept were well into their latter-day renaissance. With three straight steamrollers under their belt, expectations were high. And if U.D.O had long speculated that, quote, the new album should be good because it took them 10 years to write it, then the three merciless metal records to follow shut him up fucking profoundly, which is precisely what The Rise of Chaos did. Raw, uncompromising, breakneck badassery with that world-class Wolf Hoffman shredcraft strewn throughout. But much like its sensational predecessor, Blind Rage, it had enough presence of mind to bring the melody along for the ride. With so many personality cults ascendant in the modern era, it's apropos that Mark Tornello elected to explore one of the oft-forgotten chapters of American cult history, Jonestown. You've all heard the phrase, don't drink the Kool-Aid, but few remember the details of the tragedy in question. How one lone, drug-addicted preacher hoodwinked his fucking flock with promises of a communistic paradise.
You be kind to children. You be kind to seniors. And you take the potion like they did in ancient Greece and step over quietly. Because we're not committing suicide. It's a revolutionary act.
How that same man was so charismatic and connected to the socialist undercurrent in California politics that he managed to entrench himself with President Jimmy Carter, and in particular his wife Rosalind. How the current governor of California not only spoke at Jim Jones's church in the late 70s, but covered up all records of the mass suicide thereafter, and how after accusations of sexual assault by former church disciples, Jim Jones spontaneously elected to relocate to the jungles of Guyana to build his workers' paradise, and upon hearing of the alleged abuses of the proletariat there, a California Senator Leo Ryan opted to drop in for an impromptu visit, only to be fucking assassinated on the tarmac as he attempted to flee with news of the horrific conditions, which was filmed by the fucking by. Now, the song itself may not tell the whole story here. I mean, how the fuck could you in 5 minutes? But the cloyingly catchy chorus and driving Hoffman riff will wedge it in your head hole permanently, regardless.
Don't drink the Kool-Aid.
It's an Accept anthem, and it's not alone. From the opening assault, Die by the Sword, to the savage send-off, Race to Extinction, The Rise of Chaos is Accept at their most apocalyptic. Andy Sneap once again expertly turns the knobs in production, though I can see that from album to album he does skew somewhat on the samey side, but hey, it beats him ruining Judas Priest. Now, for an album that proudly flies the flag of the finer qualities of analog production via the infectious Analog Man, Pro Tools continues to preside over all his present-day productions. Nothing wrong with that, folks. It's crisp, it's crunchy, but am I the only one who misses the fucking flaws here? The hiss of an amp, a sloppy note or two? Balls to the Wall had that in spades, and as we arc toward a technological future, it's a crying-ass shame to watch the organic side of a street-level genre like heavy metal be consigned to the pyre of Pro Tools. Still superb, not even saying they should necessarily change it, but maybe give the knobs an extra Demi Lovato tweaker 12? It might enrich the sonic tapestry of the almighty Accept. Weak tracks, gang? It is no exaggeration to say they do not exist here. Worlds Colliding might be a smidge similar to New World Coming, but it's anything but a clone, and it slays all the same. Pick your fucking favorites, folks, because the duds do not exist. The Rise of Chaos, the optimal bookend to a fractious era that chronicles the downfall of discourse in modern America without taking sides of any description. Recommended, Riri's. That does it for this updated edition of the Metal Mythos on Accept, one of my favorite bands in existence and bafflingly as goddamn great as they ever were. I'm Razor Fist, until I emerge once more for the mists of the Mythos. God fucking speed.